So you see that the, for example, the zeros of the L of lambda plus 1 give you necessarily singularities for the Eisenstein series. So you see all the zeros or the zeta function or the Riemann zeta function, the zeros attached to the so-called Riemann hypothesis, they show up. So that what these are the things I was for the M you have seen, you have zeros here and you have poles here. That's for the M. And this is related to the behavior of the Eisenstein series. But it's a combination, so I don't want to enter that. But you see, there is an interplay between the standard. In the simplest case, you have an interplay between the Riemann zeta function and the Eisenstein series. So you see, you are on a non-trivial subject. But as regards the identity continuation, you have convergence here, you're not interested in what you have formulas. You are interested in what happened here, but of course it's reachable only by identity continuation. And passing through this point, you get a pole, and this pole corresponds to the trivial representation. When you take the residue of the Eisenstein series, it's just a constant function. So the discrete part, the discrete non-cuspidal part of the spectrum can be described directly in the case of GN2, but still it's obtained as a residue of an Eisenstein series. The trivial function, the constant is a residue of an Eisenstein series. And that's a general picture. So the general picture is that you construct Eisenstein series from cuspidal or residual, or generally discrete series, discrete spectrum representation for a Lewis subgroup. You make the construction of the Eisenstein series. It does not converge where you want. You have to analytically continue it. You have some poles that occur at the complicated places. And what is worse is that there are sometimes cancellations between the various poles. So not all poles give contribution to the discrete spectrum. Some, so that's the reason why I said mech, because all representation in the discrete spectrum come from residues from Eisenstein series. But there are residues that do not contribute, because there are cancellations. So it's a very complicated combinatorics, but I cannot describe it.
So excuse me, residue is some function of x, and it gives us element in after.
So the residue is a priori a function of f, of x, absolutely. Because you just take the residue in lambda. It turns out that here in this simple situation.
So it gives vector in an automorphic representation.
Absolutely.
And it's the one-dimensional.
In that case, it's just a trivial representation. In that simple case. But in general, of course, it depends on x, and as you said, it's an automorphic representation. Absolutely.
It's
an automorphic form.
Left one open or left to the function.
Это такое вообще не понимаю.
What is it? So I can erase this elementary formula.
I have written one new. I always forget whether there is one or two.
Fine to me. It's because of what? It's because when you have a pi lambda, and you take the W lambda. Now, if you take a small W in the phi group, R lambda. Then you can let W act on the variable, and you have pi of W of time, G W number of W of time, another one wasn't this. Well, well, lambda is unitary. These representations are equivalent. And the intertwining operator, the M, the generalized form of the M, is what sends you the space W index lambda to W index W. So you have intertwining operator generally, so what I have called M, of W and lambda. In the GL2 case, the W is simply the reflection, so it's just minus one. So you don't write it. You forget there is no W variable, we forget it. But in general, there is a W and a lambda. So which means that you get the same representation as many times as you have elements in the Weyl group, at least for lambda in the general position. Of course, at the origin it's fixed, but in general, when it is not fixed, you get more than one time. So for example here, this lambda and minus lambda, they are associated to the same representation. So you get the things more than one time. That's right. You are very happy. More than we need. But in fact, the correspondence between the two things is precisely the intertwining of weight. So the M of this M is really the thing which that controls everything. This is really the most important object in the theory. So let me say on the proof. Let me say well on the proof.
But the very difficult part is to deal
ring is a discrete non-Kaspielian representation.
Discrete non-Kaspielian representation of M lead to this very difficult.
In fact, it's completely involved. The spectral decomposition is proved at the same time as the analytic continuation. So it makes the paper by Lamont, the chapter 7. In fact, this part this is chapter 1 to 6. And this is chapter 7. So chapter 1 to 6 is anybody can read it. Chapter 7, a few people in the world have ever read it. I mean, maybe 10 or 15 or so. Not so many.
I thought that there are different opinions about validity of this paper. Yes, even now, I heard. And what is your opinion?
Well, I just tell you that there is. There has been a different, slightly different proof, slightly different, but readable. There is a readable account. By precisely the two same people, Wigner, the first person. They have written a book which has, I can give you the precise reference, but if you look in the Mugnauer's project, it was written after the GLM paper. So it's a book, there is an English version and a French version, and this is perfectly correct. I can say that there has been also independent proof in the functions it will field case by Harvard. So, no, the situation is fairly safe. But the point is that this chapter 7 by Lamont, you need some really months and months to understand what it is, because it's completely involved. It's almost impossible to follow. You need special mind to read this. Not any mathematician can make it. So, but this is possible to do. So. And now, what is the general form of the spectral decomposition?
Parabolically induced representation from
van M. Zo is parabolische detection van M. Als die eigen discretie of M, dan kan M. Tensor, I will call Chi lambda and the lambda belongs to the imaginary part of AM star divided by AG star. So that's just the dual. I take the imaginary part and the Chi lambda is Chi lambda of M. And D lambda some measure, but this makes sense under some choice. It's a bit implicit way of writing things. I will write you a precise form of it, if you prefer, but the formula is such a little longer. So let me tell you the exact formulation.
So you can say, consider P and D C. P and D C L P gamma G. So the scalar number is fixed for G. With notation that may be slightly different.
Integral and the parameter is real. It's just an integral and not a direct sum. If you have a compact object, you have a sum. So here is a mixture of this paint object and if things were compact. This is the space of automorphic representation for M. And you also have an integral over a parameter. So it's a mixture of the compact and the non-compact situation. So when n equals g, this space is zero, and it's just a sum, the discrete decomposition. Because it's a sum over sigma, and the sum over a basis is just the ordinary writing of a function in a basis. You just decompose in an hyperspace according to an orthonormal basis. But in general, it's much more complicated because you have integral over the parameters with the elements and series. So that's the situation. Okay, so now, just to finish this lecture, I think I can give you an idea of what is a trace formula in general. And we shall stop there. So, where is it? Where did I put this paper? Yes. Maybe. Yeah. So,
I mean, things that I have somewhere. Especially like for identity, the
fine. Regular means that scalar product with roots are large.
And what is more interesting is for still regular enough, large enough, then it becomes a polynomial. So it's asymptotic to a polynomial.
It's equal to the
some code. Regular n is for irregular and is a polynomial. This makes sense to have you take an element in the symmetric algebra for the dual. Okay? So this is polynomial of degree the dimension of A0, not A. But A0 is the dimension A for the minimal Levy subgroup. Okay, and you have the following expression. So you have G spectrum of G for F. First of all, it's a trace of R discrete of F plus something I cannot explain in too much detail, so G continuous. So here, what I mean by R is a regular right regular representation. Restricted and full discrete. You restrict the representation by transition to the discrete part. So this gives you an operator which turns out to be faster. This is by no means a trivial statement. The trace formula has been used for almost 20 years before one knew that this was trace class. But the fact that it is trace class is a theorem due to Müller. Trace class property. So you have to, before it was more complicated, it was not clear that it was convergent, so you have to make partial sums. And so now you can simplify a little since we know that the series are convergent, that they were conditionally convergent at the beginning. So trace of property is to Vernier. It's a constant, there is no t. This is a polynomial of degree zero. There is no dependence at all on anything. This is just the object we are interested in. But this is a kind of correction term due to the fact that the object is our space is not compact. But it has to be thought as a correction term. But it's the most complicated object to describe, unfortunately. I can give you, roughly speaking, the form. Roughly speaking, it's continuous. It's a kind of sum of integrals of traces of the so-called pi lambda of S, the operator of S. But you have an object which is usually denoted like that, m of
from that. And then buy it on that. And this object is constructed out of the intervening operator. But it's a complicated expression. For GL2, for example, it's a logarithmic derivative of the intervening operator. So for GL2, you see the derivative of the zeta function over the logarithmic derivative of the zeta function that shows up. So this is a rather subtle object, but it's still that form. So it's a sum of terms of the constant of that form. So it's a sum of integrals of stresses of the operator times a complicated formula with the intervening operator. Okay? So, now what is the continuous, the geometric part?
One of the gain a formula. So again,
You have a formula, but the point is that the volume here, the volume would be divergent. So it's not exactly the same, the d gamma. So the correct form is volume of d gamma, mod gamma gamma, and a d gamma. At the beginning it was not a problem because it was already here, it was the same. But in general it's bigger. In general, this is bigger than this. Then we have not divided the book by it. So I forgot to say that. There's no way. So you have this volume. And the orbital integral is replaced by another object, which is the weighted orbital integral. So the weighted orbital integral is of the form g over gamma of f of x minus 1 gamma x times something which depends on some n, on some divisible. So n, the divisible, such that gamma is in m of f and is elliptic. In N. So you restrict to elements that are elliptic in N. Then this is called the weight. And the weight, I will finish almost with that. The weight is a so after speaking, you can think of the M. Here you can think of AG is the M by definition because it's an elliptic in M. So here AG gamma is AM. Okay? Now, if I look at the situation for say M 0 and B equals 3, and again the picture is like that. And what is the kind of weight?
Well, you have elements in each chamber with the following picture. Here you have a square amount. Each point depends on x and d.
So you get as the volume, the weight is just the volume of this polygon. So it depends on the truncation factor and x. And you see you have essentially as many edges as elements in the vector. So it's a kind of small geometry using the vector. So that's a weight factor. The weight factor is some kind of volume. So the formation precisely the divergence was coming from the fact that the AM was bigger than AG. So you would integrate over all the vector space AM on AG, which of course is infinite. So the truncation gives you that picture in the vector space. So it replaces a divergent integral by a convergent one. Wow. That's what it is. And what remains? Unfortunately, there remains elements. There remains more general elements. So G and so gamma, not so visible. Then the formulas are not explicit, unfortunately. Because essentially the difficulty is with unipotent elements. In particular the unipotent element. And one can give expressions of the form a scalar times some kind of weighted orbital integral. So the weighted arbitrary table is defined by a limit process by making the semi-simple element degenerate to the unimodal element, at least in some directions. But the problem is that the constants outside are not explicit. But there is no nice formula except for G2. So if you want, I can write the problem in Italy for G2. But outside, except for G2, there is up to now no explicit form of the constant. So they have to be dealt with by some kind of induction process. And, okay, stop.